I don't think anybody in this room doesn't know that retirement plans are in trouble. You know that because you've seen wage freezes, you've seen contribution increases, you've seen scary notices in your mailbox. The future of secure retirement depends on our addressing those concerns in order to create a sustainable path forward. And the time for change is now. Before we get going, I need to give you a little bit of vocabulary. Many of you will know all of these terms. I'm going to try not to use lingo, just like when a carpenter comes to my house to explain how I'm going to do something at my house if I think I can do it myself. My uncle's a carpenter. He often gives me these long sort of explanations, and it helps me if he uses words I'm familiar with. So to the extent possible, I'm going to use words you're already familiar with, because my guess is you don't do pension plan design for a living. So here are my words. I'm going to say traditional defined benefit plan. That's the kind of plan you have now. I will also inadvertently call that a DB plan. DB is defined benefit. Or I'll just call it a pension plan. I'm going to try to sort of stick to the long words, but when I goof up, those three things are all equivalent. Then there's a defined contribution plan, which I sometimes call a DC plan, and you're familiar with those. They're 401k plans or a money purchase plan. Some of you have those designs as well. And then the topic of today, if you talk to people in Alaska, they call this thing a VAP, or a stabilized VAP, which stands for Stabilized Variable Annuity Pension Plan, which has, there's some legal reasons that's that way. It harks back to a revenue ruling from 1953, which is not necessarily a good reason to name a plan design, but that's how we came to that. And what happened, I don't know, within the last 6 months, is the marketing folks at Milliman, where I work, said, that is a terrible name. Nobody will want a plan design that is called a variable annuity pension plan. What they said is this: stabilized sounds like you had to sort of re-engineer it. Variable doesn't sound like a good way to design a pension plan. And so stable, and then variable annuity gets confused with an insurance product, which is, this is not, this is a pension plan. So it has been renamed the Sustainable Income Plan, or the SIP. So through my slides, I have tried to get things updated to SIP, but VAP still slips in, but VAP and SIP are identical. Any questions? Here's my suggestion. It doesn't do us any good to talk about this. If you have a question at minute 6, it doesn't do us any good if you wait until minute 50 to ask. Yeah, 50. So my suggestion is that you ask as we go. So if you have a question, come up to the mic, ask the question so everybody can hear it, and I will do my very best to answer it. It will be possible that you can ask a question I can't answer. That's a warning. All right, I want to start with where we are now, traditional defined benefit plans. You know how these plans work. You have one. You go out and you work at the job site, and the employers are putting in a certain number of cents per hour. That's in your collective bargaining agreement. I'm going to say employers put that money in. I know that for a lot of you, you've taken money off the check to do that. The reason I'm going to say that employers put that money in is legally that's how that happens. And there's an important reason why we do that legally. And the reason is, I'm going to tell you this, and the reason I'm going to tell you this is sometimes people get frustrated when I say employers put the money in. But if you were putting the money in directly, it doesn't get tax advantaged. So part of the reason we have pension plans in this country is we put the money in pre-tax, it grows tax-free, and then it's only taxed one time when you take it in retirement as income. If you were actually putting the money in, then what would be happening is we would put it in post-tax, and then you would also pay taxes on it when you retire. So legally, it's the employers putting the money in. So I'm going to say that. I actually understand the dynamic of what's happening, but that's the reason I say that. All right, so you earn benefits. Traditional plan, you're earning benefits. So you take the hours you work times the contribution coming in on your behalf times an accrual rate or a factor or a multiplier. Everybody has a different word for that. And that is your benefit you earn for the year. And we do that year after year after year. The accumulation of all of those adds up to your retirement benefit. and the plan makes a promise to pay. And legally, the plan has to pay. Though we'll talk about that a little bit more in the future here today. So employers are responsible then for making those contributions to fund those benefits. If we have a 2008, we have to put more money in to fund those benefits that weren't in the past, that used to be funded and aren't anymore because of asset declines. That's how that plan design works. That's what you have now. This design has some really great strengths. You get guaranteed benefits in retirement. You get to have a lifetime benefit that covers you and your spouse. We'll talk a little more about those guarantees. We have longevity risk that gets pooled across all the carpenters in the plan. Everybody in the plan, we have this sort of pooled longevity risk. What that means is, how many people in here have a 401k? If you only had a 401k, would you know how much to save? Would you know how much you could spend each year to make it last for your lifetime? Pools of one are very, very difficult. And that's what you get in a 401k plan, is you get a pool of one person and you have to guess how long you might live. You know, if you're my grandma, you live to 83. She basically matched life expectancy pretty perfectly. Her mother lived to 97. It's very hard to know how to spend that money. But in a pension plan, what we do is we pool that risk across everybody. And then the benefit is a promise of lifetime income. And we're able to provide that to everybody, because while I can't tell you when one person's going to die, if you give me a couple thousand people, I can tell you about how many are going to die every year. I'm going to tell an inappropriate joke. There are two actuarial jokes. Today I'm going to tell you one of them. So there are two kinds of actuaries. There are actuaries from Chicago, and then there are the rest of the actuaries. All the actuaries can tell you how many people are going to die, but the actuaries from Chicago can tell you which one. We could have used New York on that too. All right, the other great advantage of a pension plan is the assets are pooled and they're managed professionally. I know there's somebody in this room who every year they'll tell you they did better than the pension plan. Their 401k did way, way, way better than the pension plan. I'm not saying that guy doesn't exist. I'm not sure he's the same guy every year, but I'm not gonna say that guy doesn't exist. But over time, as it turns out, professional asset managers do a better job than the rest of us by about 1% a year. So instead of getting a 7% return, they're getting an 8% return. Instead of a 5%, they're getting a 6%. Not every year, but year in, year out, over time, that's what we see across the industry. That adds up to a lot of income over time. It's not very much in 1 year, but after 20 years, that's 20% more income. So we're actually better off if we let the professionals do it. There are some concerns with this plan design. So we like the strengths, lifelong income, we get longevity pooling and professional asset management, but we have seen very clearly in the last decade that there are some troubling aspects to these plans. One is, they usually don't provide inflation protection. That is not what we've been worrying about in the last decade. But they don't provide inflation protection, so you retire with a $1,000 a month benefit, which with Social Security and some personal savings does a decent job of getting you somewhere. But in 20 years, the purchasing power of that $1,000 has been eroded because inflation's been 2 or 3% a year. So it'd be nice if we had a plan design that had some inflation protection. Investment risk, that risk that we aren't going to get a positive asset return or a good asset return, and most pension plans are targeting 7% a year, is very, very difficult for a mature plan to manage. So pension plans aren't that complicated. There's a slide here in a minute that talks about that, but I want to talk about this here now. I want to talk about this word maturity, because if you listen to me talk, you're going to hear me talk about mature pension plans. Here's what a mature pension plan is. A mature pension plan is the Social Security system that right now has, oh, I'm going to have to look this up, 3.4 workers for every retiree. That's where we are in our Social Security system in this country right now. So when we have underfunding of Social Security, we only have 3.4 workers to sort of fund the benefits for our current retirees. When Social Security started, there were no retirees, or very, very few. There were actually a few. In 1945, there were 42 workers for every retiree. If we had a funding problem in 1945, it's pretty easy to spread the cost of dealing with a problem across 42 people per retiree. Right now, we're at 3.4 per retiree, and most private pension plans and multi-employer plans are in the position of having one worker for every retiree, or in some cases, two retirees per worker. I have a plan where there are about 10 retirees per worker. What do you think happens to a plan like that in 2008? You just can't recover. Like, you can't actually put enough money in on the backs of those employers and those workers to fund your way out of a problem. So maturity is this sort of natural process that happens in a pension plan. It's actually what we want to happen to a pension plan. Right? Maturity is a good thing. You set up a plan to provide retirement benefits to retirees. Ultimately, you sort of would expect you to have a whole bunch of retirees. That was the goal. So we actually don't want to, we don't want to get away from having retirees. We just want to make sure that we aren't burdening retirees with active liabilities. I said that backwards. We don't want to burden actives with retirees' liabilities. Maturity isn't a problem if your plan is funded. Let's say that retired liability is 100% funded. It doesn't cost anything, so that the dollars you're putting into your plan go to providing benefits for the active workers. It's only a problem if the plan gets underfunded. And when the plan gets underfunded, how do we shore up that difference? Where does that come from? Well, you all know where it comes from. There's only two sources of income in a pension plan: contributions or investment earnings. If you talk to a professional asset manager now, they'll tell you those earnings are not going to be as high in the next decade as they were in the 80s and 90s. They aren't even going to be close, not even close. So their predictions are, right now, in the next 10 years, it's not going to come from investment earnings, which means it has to come from contributions. And indeed, that's what we've seen over the last decade. So underfunding is really the problem. The maturity itself isn't the problem, but the resulting underfunding is. So what happens if you get underfunded? It results in contribution volatility and large contributions. It results in withdrawal liability for employers. And as it turns out, that guarantee. Remember the guarantee? That was one of the strengths of these designs. Talk to the Central States Teamsters. As it turns out, those guarantees are only good as long as the plan is funded. If your plan runs out of assets, your plan goes off to what's called the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, or the PBGC, and you get cents on the dollar on your benefits. You get something, but you don't get the guarantee. The guarantee is only good if we can keep our plans funded. And keeping them funded is harder when we're mature. Those are the concerns I have with our current plans. And you may say, well, my goodness, didn't you see this coming? And the answer is yes. We knew maturity could be a problem. When we started these plans in the 50s, 60s, 70s, a few in the 80s, they were young. We were in the position of having a whole bunch of workers for every retiree. The 70s was a volatile decade, kind of like the 90s. And so it was pretty easy to weather that time because we had so many workers for every retiree. Then we had the 80s and the 90s. Double-digit returns on average over those decades, like 15% a year, 14% a year returns over those decades. During those 20 years when we had these crazy great returns, the plans were maturing. And so when we emerged in the 2000s, we had mature plans and then a decade of flat returns. In the 2000s, we had two what we call 100-year events in that decade. First, the dot-com bubble, and then the housing and financial crisis of 2008. Those would both be considered 100-year floods, in the investment market. Those are 100-year events, two in a decade. So you may say, well, how come we didn't plan? Come on, guys, these trustees, they didn't know what they were doing. I hear this occasionally. People don't usually stop me on the street, but that did happen one time, which I don't know where that guy found my picture. Anyway, so they say, what were the trustees thinking? Well, the trustees would have saved more during those 20 years, but the laws that were in place at the time essentially limited how much money could go into the pension plan. So for those of you who were around, I think you remember this. Hey, we're gonna give everybody a 5% increase on their benefits this year. We're gonna increase the accrual rate. We're having a 13th check. They weren't spending the money willy-nilly. We were bumping up against a law that said you can't put too much money into the pension plan. That law was sort of misplaced in the multi-employer setting. It was really a law that was designed to apply to corporate plans. And in corporate plans, they were very concerned about employers using the pension plan as a tax shelter because the money goes in pre-tax. So what they were worried about is employers were taking big profits, shoving them into the pension plan and not having to pay taxes on them. So they said, you can't just use your pension plan as a tax shelter. So they put this law on that says, you have to be providing benefits sort of commensurate with the contributions you're putting in, which means you have to spend your surplus, not all of it, but a portion of it. So we went through the 80s and 90s improving benefits, and so we didn't have enough surplus to get through a flat decade. The law has since changed. It changed in 2006, which gave us 2 years until 2008 to respond. It just wasn't enough time to get us back on track. Sorry, those were both your concerns and my concerns. Underfunding, the result of all this volatility, the concerns we have is underfunding. Underfunding causes problems for all of the major stakeholders in a pension plan. It causes problems for employers. Their contributions are volatile, they are subject to withdrawal liability, it creates competitive difficulties. It causes problems for the unions. It makes organizing more difficult. The membership doesn't understand the problem. It's pretty hard to talk to people about this. They're like, my 401k balance has recovered. What's up with the pension plan? Well, it's a maturity problem. We aren't just funding your benefits. We also were funding benefits earned in the past. And ultimately, it results in less union work. Less union work causes a problem for pension plans because it results in fewer contributions coming in to help fix the problem. For actives, people have seen pay freezes. You're essentially getting smaller benefits now for larger contributions, which we call, in my industry, an intergenerational risk transfer. That's a bad thing. But what it means is, on the backs of today's actives, we're funding benefits just not just for today, but for benefits earned in the past. And for retirees, we often, it's easy to vilify retirees in this scenario because they're still getting that guarantee that we don't feel like we have anymore. But they have ceased to get ad hoc increases, so there's no more cost of living adjustments for them, so the value of their pensions is being eroded. And if the plan fails, ultimately their benefits will be cut to those PBGC levels, which are much lower than their current benefits. So it's not a riskless exercise for them either. Here's the pension funding tank, affectionately called the toilet in recent years. It's not a toilet. It just feels hard right now. Very simple. Pension plans at their core are very simple. Over the life of the plan, you're going to put in contributions and investment earnings. Well, you don't put in the earnings. You put in the contributions. The assets get investment earnings. And what comes out the bottom are benefits and expenses. That's not complicated. There aren't a bunch of levers to pull. But I would suggest to you, even though your plan may be green, and even though you think, well, gosh, we worked hard and we've really fixed our problems, another 2008 will come someday, and we are in a worse position now to handle the next 2008 than we were in 2008. And the reason is we've already pulled the levers. How many levers do we get to control here? You can control the contributions coming in, and you can control the benefits coming out. Well, and you have a tiny bit of control on expenses, I guess. I mean, you can't fire your service providers, but you know, so you have a little bit of control on expenses, but expenses are a tiny part of the plan. So really your levers effectively are contributions and benefits. And then we're gonna trust investment managers to work on the investment side because they do better than we do. Well, we have already increased contributions and we have already decreased future benefits. We don't have very many levers left to pull. In fact, this is a terrible graph until we explain it. This is very difficult to see at first, but there are two distinct lines here. The yellow line is the benefits earned, and I took this from the Alaska plan, so the Southern Alaska Carpenters plan. And I adjusted this for inflation, so all of this is in today's dollars. So you sort of have to imagine we're in an inflationless world. And we look at what the benefits are that are coming out per year of service. That's the yellow line. And you can see that, and the axis is over here on the right. So you can see people were getting as much as $300 a year for service. We're down at about 100 now. And backing that are how much is going in terms of contributions. The green line is the contribution line, also adjusted for inflation, so also all in today's dollars. You can see the crossover point is about 2003, right after the dot-com bubble, because we had this 100-year event in the investment markets. So what happens in that 100-year event? We say, whoa, we need to change this. This isn't gonna work for us. We have to do something to fix this. We're no longer hitting those maximums. Remember I told you we kept hitting up against the law? You don't hit up against the law anymore after the dot-com bubble, because now the benefits are not very well funded or not as well funded. And so you can see that guys used to get a benefit value higher than the actual contributions going in, and now guys are getting a benefit value less than the contributions they're putting in. The reason for that is that we're funding benefits earned in the past with part of the contribution. Question?
Yeah, Randy Holt, 1281. Could we have inflation-proofed our pensions during those years when we had the surplus? You know, I know nobody had a crystal ball back then. Nobody still has now, but I was just wondering, being as how we were doing the 13-year or the 13th check and what have you, if we would have inflation-proofed our funds, would it have been safer?
So are you talking about in terms of what we did in it for assets?
Yeah, we had a surplus then, and we were scrambling trying to figure out where to go ahead and come up with a 13th check or what have you. And you said that those years we did not have an inflation proofing of our funds. Could we have put an inflation proof in there, cost of living or something to that effect?
Yeah, so the question is, in case it doesn't get picked up, could we, instead of giving 13th checks and some other things, could we have put in a cost of living feature into the plan in the 80s and 90s? The answer to that is yes, that would have been legal. It's not very common outside of the public sector. It's more common in the public sector. I am great, so I'm gonna speak strictly from the actuary standpoint here. My job is to make sure the plan stays healthy. I get that everybody has their own needs, but my job is to make sure the plan stays healthy. I'm glad we didn't do that. Because if we had promised a cost of living feature in the plan back then, 2008 would have affected the plan in about the same way it did. And now we would have higher liabilities than we have. So I appreciate the thinking, but as it turns out, the way we do the calculations under the law, that would not have very dramatically changed our liability, but it would have changed our future liability profile. So that's maybe too technical of an answer, I'm not sure, but basically, let me try again. It wouldn't have changed 2008, but our liabilities would be higher now than they are, so we'd be even more underfunded. That's sort of the short answer. And that's sort of based on the way we are required to calculate liabilities under the law. So the question is, how come you multi-employer plans didn't follow what happened in the corporate sector? This is what happened in the corporate sector over the last 40 years. 40 years ago, the yellow line are private sector workers who have pension plans, how many of them were in DB plans is in yellow. DC plans are in blue, and those folks who have both DC and DB, so a pension and a 401k, are in green. And you can see that over the last 40 years, corporate sponsors basically got out of the business of providing defined benefit plans and into the business of providing defined contribution plans or 401k plans. Still 30% or so of private sector workers have a DB plan, but it's much less than it was. And occasionally people ask me this, and I'm gonna say, why would you cut off one of the legs of the three-legged stool? We have three legs to stand on in retirement. Social Security that provides a base, a pension plan that provides lifelong income on top of that, and then personal savings or a 401k type plan, which and or it'd be great if you had both. And what that does is it gives you some flexibility. Closer. Excellent. And talk loud, oh, and tilt it up. I'm learning a thing here. Is that better?
Yes.
Okay, sorry everybody. So Social Security, pension, and then personal savings. And what personal savings does is it gives you the flexibility to get your house re-roofed, to take a vacation, to provide medical pre-65. It gives you some spending flexibility in retirement. When we move from DB plans to DC plans, we essentially remove that middle leg. And we put people in the position of having to manage their 401k to last their whole lifetime. And it becomes part of their routine income and it's harder to manage. DC plans, as it turns out, these plans the private sector has switched to are causing all sorts of problems for them. They are starting to see significant workforce management issues. And workforce management is probably a term that actuaries use more than carpenters. But what that means is the old guys aren't retiring until they feel like they have enough money to retire, and that may be long after the employer wishes they would retire. The result, apparently that happens in this industry too. And the result is a couple of things. One is those younger workers don't see any opportunity for advancement for them. They don't really see what their future looks like because the guy who has the job they want doesn't leave. And so those younger workers leave. So a lot of corporate plans now are seeing sort of an exodus of their most talented workers to try to find opportunities elsewhere. So it's causing some workforce management issues for them. And in addition, as it turns out, the millennials like security. They don't want to manage their assets. They would much rather have a defined benefit plan than a 401k plan. And so this movement is starting to cause some problems for corporate sponsors. So I'd like to congratulate you all on missing that 40 years because you all still have pension plans. And together, pension plans and 401k plans are able to provide good retirement security. So my question is this, what if we could just start from scratch? Let's just start from scratch. What would we want our pension plan to be? Well, I think we want it to stay fully funded in all market conditions. That avoids that maturity problem that we know happens. That would make it easier to attract new employers. There would be no withdrawal liability. I think we should have nice, stable contributions where you say, we can put this much into the pension plan and we're prepared to get that much benefit for that. We want those contributions to pay for the benefits that are being earned today, not the benefits that were earned in the past. And we want stable benefits that'll provide lifelong income to retirees, ideally with some inflation protection. Said another way, we're looking for a design that is sustainable indefinitely, that can weather poor market experience at all levels of maturity, remain stable in all market conditions, provides meaningful benefits to all the generations of participants, and remains appealing to participants and employers no matter what's happening in the economy.
Sounds too good to be true.
It sounds too good to be true, somebody says. I paid that guy. I'd like to introduce you to the stabilized variable annuity pension plan, more commonly known now as the sustainable income plan. It actually does those things. Now, for those of you who love numbers, this is the moment you've been waiting for. What I want to do now is talk about first how the benefits work, just the mechanics. What's going to happen to benefits in a plan design like this? And then I want to talk about sort of the magic of why it works. So first, it is a variation on something called a variable annuity plan. That's how it got its stabilized variable annuity pension plan name. That variable annuity plan is based on a 1953 revenue ruling. So it is made legal by two paragraphs in a book that's that fat. It's not an insurance product. So you gotta be careful when you Google it. You gotta Google stabilized variable annuity pension plan because otherwise you get the insurance product. It stays funded in all market conditions. There were a bunch of these in the 50s and 60s and early 70s. They were not very popular due to the routine decline of retiree benefits. We'll talk about that in a minute. However, 2014, some hybrid regulations passed that really allowed the creation of the SIP, which is a modification to that design to try to mitigate the possibility of benefit declines for retirees. Here's how it works. First of all, it's a pension plan. If somebody tries to tell you it's not a pension plan, have them call me. It's a pension plan. The participant's going to earn a benefit per year of service. It goes like this. You go to work, you work a certain number of hours, the employer's putting in a certain level of contributions for you, and we multiply that times a factor. And then that's your benefit for the year. And then you do that across all the years you work, and when we add all those together, we get your benefit. That sounds a lot like the plan you have now. All right. Now, what happens is this. First of all, let me back up. The first thing I want to talk about is not the current design, not the SIP, but that 1953 plan, the one where benefits can go up and down. So what I'm describing this very instant is not your plan and not the plan we've been talking about. It is the original 1953 variable plan. Then we'll talk about what the SIP does to that. So you earn a benefit. Once the benefit's earned, it goes up and down based on the returns of plan assets. What that does is this. When the market goes up, benefits go up. Well, let's think about that. When the market goes up, that meant the assets went up. The benefits go up, which makes the liabilities go up. When the markets go down, assets go down, so the benefits go down to match. So what you have is assets and liabilities moving together in lockstep so the plan stays funded. So you're never going to be in the business of funding benefits earned in the past, but you are going to see volatile benefits. But the plan stays funded, and you're basically fully exposed to the market. So you're going to have a hurdle rate. This plan, everything in blue over the next few pages is a brand new word that you aren't familiar with based on your current plan. So this plan has what's called a hurdle rate, usually set between 4 and 5%. I'm going to use 4% for my example today. We're going to calculate the liabilities at the hurdle rate. That means that your accrual out of the gate, you know, we take hours times contributions coming in times the accrual rate. The accrual rate has to be lower in this plan design. So the initial accrual, the year you accrue it, it'll be lower than what you're currently getting if the cost to the plan is the same. So we're going to calculate liabilities in a more conservative way. And then we're going to make sure we fund the benefits. You already do that. And then those benefits that you earn are going to fluctuate based on the market returns. When you get a return more than the hurdle rate, benefits go up by the difference. So if we have a hurdle rate of 4%, you get a 6% return, benefits are going to go up about 2%. If you have a 4% hurdle rate and we get a 2% return, benefits are going to go down about 2%. If you got a 4% return every single year, it would function just like your current plan. There would never be any benefit changes. Over time, we expect, I want to go back to this point about liability, you're going to have a lower accrual, it's not slightly lower, you're going to have a lower accrual out of the gate. But what do we think will happen to this? If I expect a 4%, if I'm calculating liabilities at 4% and your benefits go up every time we get more than 4%, what do assets earn over time? 6, 7, 8%? Over time, those benefits are going to go up. They go up while you're working, and they keep going up through your retirement. When you die, and the benefits going to your spouse, they keep going up. So the benefits continue to go up over your entire lifetime. So if two things are gonna cost the same, let's say you earn $100 today in your current plan, and what you're gonna get at retirement is $100, and then $100 for that year of service the rest of your life, and we're gonna now have something new that has a different, that has the exact same cost, but it's gonna go up over time. I can't start at the same point when you're 40. So it starts lower here, and then it's expected to go up over time, and the cost over your lifetime is still the same. The accruals you get when you're young increase a lot. The accruals when you get when you're a little older don't increase as much because you don't have as many years of returns applied to those accruals. So let's look at a retiree in this plan design. He has a $1,000 a month benefit. We have a plan with this 4% hurdle rate. He retires and gets $1,000 a month for his first 12 months. So for that first year out of the gate, he's getting $1,000 a month. He's super happy. He's good to go. The plan gets a negative 1% return that year. So at the end of the year, his benefit's going to go down about 5% because we're comparing to that 4% hurdle rate. So 4 down to minus 1 is about 5% difference. So we're going to take that $1,000, and every year we do this calculation, we take 1 plus the return, in this case negative 1, divided by 1 plus the hurdle rate, which is always 4%. So his second year in retirement, he gets $952. And he gets that for 12 months. The next year, the plan gets a 16% return. We're going to do the exact same calculation. We take the $952, the benefit from the prior year, we're going to multiply it by 1 plus the return, so 1 plus 16% divided by 1 plus the hurdle rate, and the third year of retirement, he gets $1,062. That looks okay. 2008 would have looked pretty horrible. So this is the basic design. Those 2014 hybrid regulations allowed us to create the sustainable income plan, or the VAP. Here's kind of what happened. I'll tell you that story in a little bit. All right. We want to improve on that because we don't really want retiree benefit declines. It's hard for retirees to see benefit declines. It makes them feel insecure about what's going to happen to them. So we added some new features. We add a cap. What we're going to do is this. In years with particularly high returns, we're going to shave off a portion of that upside and hold it back in reserve so that when benefits would otherwise have gone down, we'll have a stabilization reserve set aside to shore everybody's benefits up. So it's sort of some saving within the plan to provide benefit stability to retirees. So I'm going to say those words again. We're going to cap returns in particularly high years to build a reserve that we're going to spend when benefits would otherwise have gone down to shore guys' benefits up. That's the new twist. So let's take that same guy, that same retiree, $1,000 a month benefit. He's the first year he's retired, he gets $1,000 a month. We get that same negative 1% return. So we do the same calculation, 1 plus the return over 1 plus the hurdle rate. He has a $952 benefit that's fully funded. But that's $48 less than he was hoping to get. So we have a stabilization reserve. And that stabilization reserve is sufficient, so we pay him $48 from the stabilization reserve. So that in his first year of retirement, he gets $1,000 a month, and in the second year of retirement, he gets $1,000 a month. $952 of a fully funded benefit, $48 from the stabilization reserve. The next year, the third year, we get that same 16% return. So we're gonna do this calculation. Oh, there's this one more feature. The plan has a cap. And we've said, and this is nobody's plan design. This is a fictional plan design. So what we have is a plan with a 10% cap. What we're gonna do is say that we don't really need to give guys more than a 10% benefit increase in any one year. So we go through the exercise of doing this calculation, 1 plus the return over 1 plus the hurdle rate. That would suggest that we should get an 11.5% benefit increase. But we have a 10% cap. So we're only gonna give the guys a 10% increase. And that other 1.5% is gonna build more reserves for use when benefits go down in the future. So we don't give that guy an 11.5% increase, we give him a 10% increase, so So his benefit in the third year of retirement is $1,047. He'll be pretty happy with that, probably. He's not going to be too upset about that. But we notice we apply it to that underlying benefit, not to $1,000, but to his underlying benefit from last year. So he gets $1,047. It's a little less than he would have gotten before, but we've built reserves for the future. And now the $1,047 is his new high watermark. So when we go to spend in the future, we aren't trying to protect $1,000. We're now going to try to protect $1,047 so that over time, he sees his benefit go up and up with some inflation adjustment. That's the plan. Questions?
So my question is, why are
you? So the mic.
Why are you?
Darrell Duffy, 1503. So I have two questions. How much is allowed to hold in reserves for the stabilization plan, and how many years of negative returns could they sustain?
Two great questions. So the first question is, how big can the reserves get? And the answer is that legally they can get up to be, you could get a plan 140% funded by law. So remember when I said before you used to have to sort of spend over funding? Well, now you can get clear to 140% without having to spend over funding. So that will ultimately result, the trustees will make decisions that we'll have what's called a funding and benefits policy where trustees will write down their best thinking on that. But that number could change if we see different prospects for returns in the future. So the goal is we're sort of working through, as I mean, what trusts need to do is work through what their tolerance is for a possible benefit decline. That is, if you don't have enough reserves in this plan, retiree benefits go down. So you want to have sufficient reserves that you can pay benefits even in a bad decline, and you also want to balance that with being able to provide bumps in the benefit. You know, if you get way overfunded, what are you going to do? You're going to go back and give everybody a 5% bump or something on their underlying benefits. So that'll be a trustee decision, and we work through that doing some what I call stochastic modeling, where we look at 1,000 scenarios of possible future returns to try to balance the two needs of inflation protection in the benefit versus being able to shore up. I will answer your second question in a minute. I've got some slides on how bad of a situation you can weather. Sorry.
That's okay. Don Samrat, Local 30. I have two questions also. And pardon my ignorance, but when you say that the defined benefit plan that we currently have is guaranteed, could you briefly explain what that guarantee is and where that would go? And the other question I have is that you say in a perfect world where we get to design our new plan from scratch and do whatever we want, ideally we would use today funding to fund today and tomorrow's liabilities, whereas currently we're using today's funding to fund the liabilities of the past. If we change, what funds the liabilities of the past that we currently have?
Good question. Okay, so this plan design does not change your benefits earned in the past, and B, it does not fund your benefits earned in the past. So this is a long-term solution. This isn't a solution that fixes the funding of the current plan overnight. So what this does, so to answer your question, if you go down the path of putting in a sustainable income plan, let's say right now you're funding a certain amount. I'm gonna make up some numbers. This is nobody's plan in this room. Let's say you're putting in $5 an hour and two of them are going to fund benefits earned in the past and three are going to provide benefits now. When we convert to a SIP, we're still gonna be putting $2 into the traditional plan to fund benefits earned in the past, and we're gonna put $3 in to earn benefits in the SIP. So that math will be the same. So if you are currently funding benefits earned in the past, you will continue to do that until those benefits are funded. So, and then what happens is all we really are doing is each year at the time, one year at a time, we are not adding more risk to the plan. And I'll show you sort of an illustration of that in a little bit, of kind of what happens over time.
Dave Howard, Local 129. What happens to any member that's not vested in the previous plan and we move to a new one?
So vesting will stay, so first of all, there's only gonna be one plan document. there's only going to be one plan. It's just we're going to have two different benefit structures in the plan. Through some date, you would have the traditional benefits, and then after that date, you would have new benefits. So a guy who's partially vested in the old plan, every year of service in the SIP will count for his old vesting, and every year in the old plan will count for the new vesting. So nobody's harmed on vesting. Depending on how you set your plan up, you may actually get a shorter vesting schedule.
Right, Ike, Local 196. So if we chose to go with the SIP plan, what would happen to the defined benefit plan that we currently have that's not 100% funded?
You still have to fund those benefits. So you would still be in the business of diverting the same money you're diverting now to fund that plan will still happen until that plan's funded.
So we would take a portion of our contributions and direct them to the defined benefit plan, and then the other portion would go to the SIP plan. Is that correct?
Yes, and legally there'll be one plan. So your collective bargaining agreements will look pretty much the same.
So how would we strengthen that SIP plan if you're only contributing a portion that is needed to strengthen that plan?
Ask that question again, I'm not sure I understood.
So there's a certain amount that it takes to strengthen and grow that SIP plan. How would you do that if you're only contributing a fraction of your contribution to that SIP plan?
Right.
And the other portion going to the defined benefit plan until it's 100% funded?
Gotcha, so we want a reserve in the SIP. So there are a couple of things you can do. One is you could say we're going to take a little portion that's currently earning benefits and put that toward the SIP reserve. In Alaska, they negotiated some additional cents per hour to build that reserve out of the gate. So there's a lot of ways to do that. If a plan is pretty close to funded and is putting some money to build the traditional plan, they might say, hey, we're going to take a little bit from that funding of past benefits, you know, that will delay getting to 100% by a year or two in order to build the reserve. So there's a lot of ways to do that, and those will end up being pretty plan specific, kind of based on where the plans are, how well funded they are, et cetera.
Jason Shuckler, 1503. What I was wondering, and God forbid this happened, I would say we want our union to grow, but let's say we get right to work, you know, our union membership goes down to about half. And you were saying before, correct me if I'm wrong, that there is opportunity to, if it gets so bad and there's not reserves, to cut those defined benefits of retirees. So let's say we lose half our membership. What happens to those retirees' defined benefit plan if that happens?
So the same thing happens to those retirees whether you have a SIP for new benefits or not. If the same scenario you're describing happens in 20 years, it would mean less cuts to retiree benefits. But if you implement a SIP in a year, you know, we haven't changed the risk profile of the plan very much in a year because we're only going to chew off the risk a year at a time. So effectively what has to happen to retiree benefits without a SIP and with a SIP looks the same in the early years of the SIP. It's only down the road 15 or 20 years where it really changes that and it provides better security on those retiree benefits earned in the past. So he's referring to, so for many years by law, pension benefits were protected, 100% protected by law, which just meant they had to get funded. Don't mind that we looked at the equation for how that gets done and it's hard to get done. But there was this guarantee of benefits. And so now under some new pension laws sort of in response to plans being so underfunded, there's an opportunity for very poorly funded plans or plans that are have some other funding difficulties to actually reduce retiree benefits. None of your plans are in that predicament, but for those plans, you would have sort of the same exercise in either case. I guess I should say, if you were starting a SIP from scratch, we'd never be in that boat. But we aren't. We're starting with where we are.
Mixed Dial, Local 1503. My question was, at this current rate, if we took the $2 that would go into the SIP plan and funded our current retirement, what is the difference in cost, or do you know what the difference in cost would be for us to shore up our plan in order to continue along through this flat period with low interest rates until we can get back to an interest rate that is more friendly to our plan in the 3 to 4% range rather than the 1 point?
So the question is, what could we do to the current plan to make it more sustainable? And the answer to that is very plan specific. So I can't, I mean, it depends on the plan. It depends on how many actives you have compared to retirees. It depends on how much you're currently funding to pass benefits. So the answer is, I can't answer that unless we look at a specific plan. But the concern I have is, let's say you could get your current plan funded. We talk about something called a break-even accrual rate, not usually with anybody but actuaries. But a break-even accrual rate is one where the contributions coming in match the value of benefits accruing for the year. And when I do that calculation, that accrual rate is usually between 2 and 2.5%. So we are probably not ever going to go back in the entire time I'm an actuary to a 3 or 4% accrual. Because when you're at a 3 or 4% accrual, that means that the value of benefits accruing in the year is actually bigger than the contributions coming in to back those benefits. So when you remember back to a 4% accrual rate, the source of funding for that accrual rate was not just contributions, but excess returns in the market. And I have no idea if we'll ever get back to the point that we're gonna get double digit returns to fund that difference. If I did, I wouldn't be an actuary. In fact, I wouldn't be working at all.
Yeah, Sean Cushman, 1503 also. I think some of the, when I was listening to the different questions, we're talking about when you take the $5 and split it up to the new SIP plan and the $3 going to the existing SHORA, that shoring up plan will go and be paid out in contributions till the people that are in it, invested in it now, actually complete and the money is changed, correct? And then the new SIP plan, the $2, we actually look at building with no output until the people reach the time that they would actually be vested in it and retire from now on. So you said earlier that there could be a quicker vested time in the SIP plan. What's the time difference? Ballpark, I know I'm going to do that.
Yeah, let me just use the Southern Alaska plan as an example. If the trustees choose a hurdle rate, remember the hurdle rate is sort of what we leverage the benefit increases around. If you choose a hurdle rate less than 5%, by law, you have to move to a 3-year vesting schedule. So when we look at the Southern Alaska guys, and remember we're going to add vesting together for the traditional plan and the SIP plan. So for guys in Southern Alaska, if a guy who already is vested in the Southern Alaska plan, the traditional plan is already vested in the SIP out of the gate. So we already have retirees with SIP benefits in Alaska because we started 1/1/15. So that guy who worked 3 months and retired has this wee tiny portion of his benefit that's a SIP benefit. So guys will start retiring right away, but it takes some time for there to be significant benefits from the plan. Did that answer your question? Okay.
John Corbelson, Local 30. So I'm going to talk about Western Washington's plan. So we have projections that we're going to make 7%, and then we also have projections that we're going to work $11 million per year, and we just had to divert 25 cents to keep our plan from going into the yellow in 2018. And so even with this construction boom and even with the funding status of where we're at, our plan is still losing money and our funding is going down. And I understand that we're going to continue to pay the benefits that are promised, but from someday forward, we're going to do this new accrual rate. So have we made any projections for what Western Washington would make, you know, what it's going to take to continue to fund that and what our future benefits would be if we made the nuts that you keep saying that we're going to make? So do we have the number yet for what Western Washington, you should be able to do that calculation and see what it's going to take to fund those. What we're going to go forward with.
So here's what I'm going to say about that. First of all, Western Washington is exploring this idea. They haven't decided to do this. And what I would encourage you to do is talk to a trustee on that plan. I don't really want to get into dollars on every plan. We have not finalized those numbers because, first of all, the decision hasn't been made, but also as trustees are thinking about that decision, they're thinking about a number of factors. So we don't have any kind of firm analysis on that yet because we're still thinking about several different things, and I'm not the plan's actuary, so I think it'd be best if you talk to one of the trustees on that plan to see if they can answer your question.
Thank you, Mr. Josh Berry, Local 146. How will the SIP plan affect our early subsidized retirement option or the ADNL to the current plan that we have now?
Again, plan provisions are sort of the purview of trustees. So if you think about a plan contemplating making a change like this, remember I said the, you know, the initial accruals are lower and then expected to increase with inflation over time, which is different than now you accrue them at $100 and they're still $100 later. You know, here you're going to accrue them at $70, $60 or $70, and they're going to go up over time. One of the factors that trustees consider then is, are there plan features in our plan that we want to give up in order to get a higher accrual rate? So those are decisions that trustees will make with their service providers as they walk through the process of deciding what the right plan is.
They're all about 1503. I mean, I think this is the most key and fundamental question to working members, and I really didn't understand your answer to the question, and I think at the end of the day, that the 20,000 members that work under these agreements, this is their key question, and they need to understand your answer.
Okay, so the question is, so let me make sure I understand the question. The question is, what happens to Rule of 80?
Right.
Okay. First of all, Rule of 80 doesn't go away for benefits earned in the past. So if you imagine a plan doing this starting in, say, 2016, let's say we started back in January 2016, anything earned in the past would still have the Rule of 80. Trustees are going to weigh the following options. Let's say that if you keep the Rule of 80, you can have a 0.6% accrual rate. This is no plan in particular. You can have a 0.6% accrual rate. Remember, the accrual rate is what we multiply contributions by to get the benefit. If you get rid of Rule of 80, you can have a 0.7 accrual rate. So trustees need to weigh which of those things is more important. So that happens on a case-by-case basis. There is nothing about a SIP that says you can't have a Rule of 80, and there is nothing about plan design that guarantees a Rule of 80. So that ultimately is a plan design decision that the trustees would make.
Ron Robbins, Local 146. Just to be clear, the SIP would not require that the Rule of 80 goes away.
That's correct. Okay, one other question. And then I feel like we should, my understanding is I'm keeping you from some other important business, so. Okay. Okay, all right. All right, and we got to weigh those. Thank you for the clarification.
Local 81. You talked about our cap being a fictitious cap right now at 10 or 11.1%. Do we have a real cap?
So the Southern Alaska Carpenters Plan has an 8% cap.
Okay, thank you.
That's the only plan. There, we have a non-carpenters plan in New Jersey that has a 5% cap. So. The Southern Alaska Carpenters Plan has a 4% hurdle rate and an 8% cap. We have a plan in New Jersey that has a 5% hurdle rate and a 5% cap. The way the trustees get at that, those numbers is they're, I can't even explain, all of these parts move together. All of these things we've talked about, the cap, the hurdle rate, what you're gonna hold in the amount of reserves. I mean, somebody asked the question, how big of reserves do you need? All of those things, when you change one of them, it changes the others. And what we try to do is get a plan design that provides good benefits with sort of a desired inflation protection without having there be a high probability that retiree benefits will ever go down. And we have to balance all of those. So when you move one, the others move. So there's a lot of ways to look at that. So you're going to see something different from different plans because they have different asset allocations. They have different investment managers that have different asset allocations. There's maybe a different need for security depending on the group or a different risk tolerance among the trustee group. Does that make sense? There's a lot of moving parts. So they aren't all going to look the same.
Carson Keller, Local 30. I'm watching the South County Alaska pension plan video that was made. At one point, it does say that the benefits could run out, and once they're gone, And I just wanted to see what that meant by, it says something about you have to watch how much you spend every year because once the benefits are gone, they're gone. And so I was just hoping you could clarify that for us.
In that slide, I think they're talking about 401k plans. That if you're trying to fund your retirement with a 401k plan only, that once your 401k assets run out, they're gone, which just doesn't.
I'll double check that.
Yeah, so it doesn't happen in either the traditional plan or the SIP.
Keith Montgomery, Local 1281. Kelly, can you talk about how organizing and market share and employer health with this plan, it's easier to obtain that? I might be ahead of you.
No, that's okay. I'm not going to pretend to know anything about organizing, but I can tell you from my understanding of how workforces work, what I think you might have going for you. Again, right now you have underfunding from legacy plans, from the past plan. But when I sort of imagine what organizing looks like as you go down this path, if you can offer new employers no withdrawal liability, which you won't be able to do for some years because you have the legacy plans attached, but if you can say there's no withdrawal liability, and as we have younger workers that really don't want their parents' 401k plans, having a sustainable plan that is desirable to employers because they aren't going to have underfunded liability, and desirable to participants because they don't have to manage their own money, I think you'll be in a pretty good spot.
When you say about that unfunded liability, those new contractors that are being organized, they're not on the hook for the previous liability of the new.
I wish I could say that was true.
It's not?
That's not true. So because you work in construction industry plans, there are some, you could do that if you weren't construction industry plans. You could actually bifurcate and new employers wouldn't be on the hook for the old liability. But because you're a construction industry plan, there is a mandated withdrawal liability method that we use. It's called the presumptive method. You never, I hope, never need to know that. And that method, if you could imagine that we were gonna get 7% returns every year, then new employers would never be on the hook for that liability. But what happens is when we get a down year, because now that produces new underfunding in the traditional plan, new employers would be on the hook for the difference between the funding at the beginning and end of the year, only their little portion of it. So we really need to get to the point that the traditional plans are well funded before we can tell employers there's no withdrawal liability.
Ron Robbins, Local 146. Can you explain, as we deal with the unfunded liability in the old plan, how those funds over time can be shifted toward benefits in the new plan?
Sure, so I'm gonna give sort of the big picture analysis of this. So you let's say we're down the road a few years and every multi-employer plan in the country has a SIP, and so we're looking at an industry where there's some underfunded old benefits and then you've got new SIP benefits. And we get to the point where we're 100% funded on the legacy liability. Well, 100% funded doesn't make me feel very secure because you get 1 year at 0% and now you're 7% underfunded because we're assuming you're going to get 7% returns. So I would like the plan to be better than 100% funded. I'd feel pretty comfortable if we were at 110% funded. I like 120 better, but I'm an actuary. So what you can do is this. There are a bunch of options. I'll tell you what the legal options are. You could continue to run the plan at 120% funded so that it's secure and can withstand a downturn so that it doesn't cause you funding problems. You could, if interest rates come up a little bit, you could potentially purchase some annuities. So occasionally you see plans say, hey, for all of our current retirees with the traditional plan, we'll just purchase annuities for them. They'll continue to get their benefits, but they're no longer in the plan. You could move to a more conservative asset allocation for that portion of the liability. So what you could do if you were 120% funded, pension plans actually look like bonds. So, you know, we invest in stocks and bonds. A pension liability looks a lot like a bond. So if you invest the assets backing that liability with bonds, they move together better than if you invest in equities. So one option would be to say, we're gonna keep that liability in the plan, we don't wanna purchase annuities, but we're gonna back that with a portfolio that matches it better. So those are the kinds of things trustees can look at when that time comes. Okay, I'm going to keep talking, one more, and then we can do this every slide, apparently till tomorrow sometime.
I'm Phil Newkirk, non-delegate, Local Union 146, the Western District Vice President. Just from a national perspective, funding liability, it poses a problem for the UBC and all of the building trades and all of the other unions. But with us, specifically, just as an illustration, I met with the Vice President of a major construction firm, I'm not going to name the name, international construction firm in Colorado. They were going to walk away from their agreement. The agreement was up, it was expiring. and why was that? It was because of funding liability. They're big enough and well-heeled enough to go ahead and eat it for that area. But what the vice president told me was that they were looking at doing this throughout the country over an extended period of time. Now, this firm employs thousands of carpenters. That's just one example of what the threat of funding liability poses for us. And not to mention what it poses for signing new contractors that are going to be faced with funding liability. Not to mention new members that may be employed by that new contractor when, say, they're going to only get a dollar benefit for a $5 contribution. That's the challenge that it poses for organizing. Thank you.
Let's talk a little bit about the stabilization reserve. I actually think we've covered everything here. I just want to make sure I don't miss something that you need to know. So we mentioned both benefit structures are in the same plan. The assets and liabilities will be tracked separately, because remember, we're going to do a shore up only when we can afford to do a shore up in the SIP portion. So we need the SIP benefits to be more than 100% funded, but we know your traditional liabilities are probably less funded than that. So on paper, they're all, in real life, they're all in one pool, but I'm going to track them separately so that we can talk about the funded status of the two separately. The IRS and the government, they only care about the total plan, but we're going to be looking at the two pieces so that we can do shore ups. The reserves, that stabilization reserve can come from two sources: specific contributions to build that reserve, or years when we get outperformance in the market. And the shore ups will be paid whenever we have sufficient reserves. So the goal is to have the plan operate above 100% funded so that you can be doing those shore ups. If the reserves run out, the plan will be 100% funded, but we won't be in the position of doing retiree shore ups. There was a question, how does it really work in real life? So I have three back testing scenarios. We set up a plan, this is my fictional plan, where we have a 4% hurdle rate, 10% cap, meaning benefits won't go up more than 10% in a year. And then I said, we're going to let the plan get 150% funded. Fine, whatever, let it be 150% funded. And we're going to invest it in a balanced portfolio, 70% stocks, 30% bonds, and we're going to let the plan start at 115% funded. I actually think we probably want those SIP benefits to be 115 to 125% funded. That depends a little bit on what you set for your hurdle rate and your cap. It depends on which actuary you talk to. So we're working to build more robust models all the time, but we think that a reasonable funding target's 115, 120, maybe 125. So let's see what happens. I want to tell you first what these lines are. The dark blue lines, that's that 1953 VAP, that 1953 variable annuity plan. So these are the plans that were actually in place in the 50s and 60s and 70s. The orange line is the SIP, where we smooth out the ride for retirees. And the green line, to give you a point of reference, is inflation. So let's talk about inflation first. This starts in 1926. You can see there's a big run up. Well, let me back up. 1926, we get essentially the stock market crash in 29 through 32, and you can see there was deflation during that time period. So inflation actually is a little negative and then comes up at the end of the period. Here's what happens to the basic SIP benefit. You can see that it goes up dramatically at first. It goes up from $1,000, which would have been an enormous retirement benefit in 1926, incidentally. The $1,000 a month benefit up to above $1,500 over the first 3 years of retirement, and then it gets cut in half over the following 3 years as the stock market crashes, and then it's a bumpy ride clear through this retiree's lifetime. That's sort of what we wanted to avoid with the basic variable plan. So the SIP, you can see the increases happen in those first 3 years, but we are hitting the cap every year, so the increases weren't as big as they would have been in the traditional plan, building reserves. Then what happens is the underlying benefit, remember how there's the underlying benefit and the high watermark? Well, 3 years, the benefit gets cut just about in half, and then the underlying benefit bounces around below the high watermark for about 20 years. But at the end of that 20-year period, the benefits start going up, and we never saw a time when benefits declined. So the reserves in the plan were sufficient to get the plan through the Great Depression. Let's look at another back-tested period. Let's look at 1955 through 1984. So again, we're gonna start with a $1,000 a month benefit. The 50s and 60s had nice, smooth returns. Look what those returns look like. You'll notice that the benefits in the SIP and the orange line lag behind the benefits in the traditional, or the basic plan, the blue line. We don't see any benefit declines, but it lags a little. That's because we're building reserves right along. And then you can see the bear market of 1973-74 with that dip in the blue line. So you can see that then that the SIP plan was level for a few years and then continues to grow. So what happens is we are able to provide benefit increases when the markets are good, and avoid benefit declines when the markets are bad. You can see the benefits mostly keep pace with inflation until we get to the late 70s and early 80s when we had double-digit inflation, and the 70s was a volatile decade in the markets. So you can, so ideally we're getting some inflation protection, but it's not like an inflation hedge. It's not gonna be perfectly matched to inflation. And then let's look at the most recent time period. We start with a $1,000 a month benefit, and this guy gets the 80s and 90s. And you can see that the benefits go up dramatically. Both the blue line, that'd be without any stabilization reserves, and the orange line, which is with stabilization reserves. And you can see the benefits go up and up and up. The reason they go up so much is that the plan keeps hitting 150% funded, and we had to model something, so we bumped the benefits up. Just like you used to get, hey, we'll just increase everybody's benefit by 5 or 10%, that's happening in this scenario. But it's happening in a way that the plan is still gonna be 120 or 130% funded coming out of 2008, which is way better than what our traditional plans were able to do. You can see both the dot-com bubble and the 2008 housing and financial crisis, those are the two great fangs in the blue line. And you can see that the SIP benefits ride through that time period, and they're flat for a few years, which is a great outcome. In terms of what's happening in a plan like this, you can see what's happening on the benefits side, but on the contribution side, you'd be still putting in the nice, smooth contribution you'd always been putting in, because you're never in the position of trying to fund benefits earned in the past. So when we talk about this, what happened when we backtest this, you can see the benefits lag a little in bull markets, but we get downside protection with the benefits staying flat, and generally the benefits keep pace with inflation. And we get to maintain a nice 70-30 allocation. We get to keep invested in equities and bonds. We don't have to be more conservative or get more aggressive.
Scott Hansen, Local 1281. Back on that back slide, I just wanted to make sure. At the $1,000, at the beginning of that, whatever year it was, that would be the traditional DB plan where your flat line straight across, because it doesn't show it on there, right?
Right.
But that's, it would be flat lined at 1,000, so that shows the difference of where a SIP plan can go.
Yes, that is where a SIP plan can go. It is not where I anticipate a SIP plan will go anytime in the next 10 years for sure.
But
for the retirees in that area. Now, to be fair, let's say the guy retires with a $1,000 a month benefit from a traditional plan. That guy saw over that time period, he saw benefit increases where we just said, hey, we're going to increase everybody's benefit in the plan. He saw lots of 13th checks. There were some ad hoc COLA adjustments. So a retiree from many, many pension plans in this country would have seen some benefit increases over that time period as trustees were spending what they had to make sure the plan still met the requirements of tax deductibility. For those of you not yet convinced of the magic of this and the skeptics in the room, first of all, I honor you. I appreciate a little skepticism. I want to talk about risks. Now, I could spend 2 hours talking about risks, but instead I'm going to spend about 4 minutes talking about risks. If you want to talk in detail about what these risks mean, we can do that. But I want to talk about the major retirement risks, four major retirement risks that people face, that pension plans face. It's not just in retirement. And I want to sort of allocate them as either small risks, medium risks, or large risks. And we're going to put them on this balance beam. How do we balance employers versus participants in a traditional plan? The first risk is interest rate risk. And interest rate risk is the hardest one to talk about. But remember when you could go to the bank and you'd put money in a CD? How many people have done that lately? All right, so you know what interest rate risk is. Interest rate risk, when you can get good returns, that's good for savers. Pension plans are savers, right? We're saving money in a pension plan for the future. So interest rate risk is kind of whether the current market favors savers or spenders. And it's a big risk for pension plans. It's sort of a hidden risk, but it's there. And it's a big risk. And in a traditional plan, it's borne by the employers. And then there's investment risk. Everybody knows what investment risk is, right? Did you pick the right stock? Were you in stocks? Did you get out at the wrong time? Everybody's familiar with investment risk. And in a traditional plan, it's borne by employers. Again, I know that investment risk, and actually coupled with interest rate risk, affects your pocketbooks and your retirements. I know that. But we put it on the employer side because legally it's their obligation. And then there's longevity risk. We don't know how long people are going to live. And occasionally the actuary comes to the plan, the trustees, they roll their eyes when I talk. And I say, people are living longer, which seems like a good thing, right? But to a pension plan, I mean, I love you people, but when you live 18 more months, that costs money. I mean, when your numbers, I'd like you to die sooner. When your people, I'm all for longevity risk. What was that?
Where are you from?
I am not from Chicago. Good news for you. I actually was born and raised in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, which I know is a right to work state, but I moved to Washington. So longevity risk, as much as the trustees hate it when I come and say liabilities are going up 3% because people are living longer, it's pretty small potatoes compared to, that was an Idaho joke, compared to investment risk. So that risk is borne by employers, and participants bear inflation risk because most pension plans don't provide routine cost of living adjustments. So on balance, in a traditional defined benefit plan, the risks are largely borne by the sponsors, by the employers. But what if you did what the corporate world did and you switched to 100% DC, 100% 401k? 100% money purchase, however you arrange that. Here's what happens to those risks. Investment risk moves over and lands squarely on the shoulders of participants. I'd rather have the professionals do it than me do it. Longevity risk gets huge. Maybe it's huge. Longevity risk gets big, and it gets big because I don't know how long Laird's going to live. I just don't know. Interest rate risk is also borne by participants, and mostly people in 401k plans encounter that if they try to, when they're saving or if they try to purchase an annuity for part of their retirement income. We move all of the risks wholly onto the participants, and they're actually bigger in total than they were when they were balanced between the two. So I don't think that's a great option. And there's another problem with 401k plans that we haven't talked about. This is what happens in any retirement plan, 401k, traditional DB, SIP, VAP. We put money into the plan, and we expect that money to grow to produce retirement income in retirement. But there are some real drains in a 401k plan, and they go like this. You aren't going to do as well as the professionals unless you're that one magic guy. You don't have the advantage of longevity pooling, which means you may probably either aren't going to spend enough or you're going to spend it all and it's not really going to produce retirement income. And you lack professional, and you're going to pay higher fees when you're retired. Either a DB plan or a SIP, which is a DB plan, but any defined benefit plan is actually going to produce at least 30% higher benefits than a DC plan. Because those drains on the DC plan result in real dollars, fewer dollars in retirement. So I think you should be in a DB or a SIP and not a 401k for the bulk of your retirement savings. I think DC has its place. I think it's great in combination with a pension plan because it gives you some flexibility of spending in retirement. And I actually think it's an important part of the retirement picture. I just think it's not good to replace the pension piece with the 401k piece. So let's start with the DB risks again, the traditional plan risks. This is your risk profile now. What happens to that risk profile when we move into a sustainable income plan? We minimize inflation risk. Because the benefits are going up over time, it doesn't eliminate the risk, but it really minimizes that risk. It essentially eliminates interest rate risk. We're going to keep the longevity risk with the employers, because remember what happened when we put it with the employees, with the participants? That was a disaster. We don't want to make risks bigger. Our goal is to get risks smaller. And we're going to put the investment risk on the participants. But with the stabilization reserves, we think it's going to have a minimal impact on folks. The reason the sustainable income plan works is that we have minimized the retirement risks to the extent possible and then allocated those remaining risks in the most rational way so that we actually end up with a plan that has less risk in it than either of the predominant plan designs in place today. All right, we have talked about these. What are the pros and cons? Let's start with the pros. The plan, a SIP, stays well-funded in all market conditions. You get stable contributions over time. It doesn't negatively impact collective bargaining. You actually can get lifelong benefits with the longevity pooling. Some inflation protection is expected, and there's no risk transfer from one generation to another. You fund the benefits that you will ultimately receive, and the next generation funds the benefits they will ultimately receive. What are the cons? Benefit decreases are possible. If you run into a scenario where out of the gate we lose 50% of the market value, benefits will go down in a SIP. We won't have reserves to get through that. Now, if we lose 50% of the value in the market, we're going to have way bigger problems than 1 year of SIP accruals. But it is possible that benefits go down in this design, and if that happens, you'll be subject to that market risk. Again, we're putting plans in place to build reserves with some contributions and without performance in the market. So the one last thing there is the accrual rates are going to be smaller at the outset. They're expected to go up over time, but there's a little bit of a problem when you look at that first year benefit statement. You know, you're going to get a smaller initial accrual in the SIP than the DB plan, which there's sort of some communication around that.
Evelyn Shapiro, Local 30. Kelly, some members have asked me if this plan is so great, why is it all of a sudden popping up now? Could you describe that process and why this is coming to us now?
Sure. Actuaries have known about this plan design for a long time. It was very hard in the 80s and 90s plans seemed like they were working fine. It didn't really seem like there was a problem. And most actuaries were not talking about it. So as much as those two paragraphs were known by some actuaries, we weren't really talking about it very much. I actually found out about these plans in 2000, oh, I don't know, seven maybe, 2006 or 2007, and then maybe 2008. Anyway, really, I think there's been a lot of interest since the downturn in thinking about it. So trustees weren't aware, I think, because people weren't really talking about it. I think that for a long time, people thought we would continue to get really great returns and that a change wouldn't be necessary. And even when we talked about it, and when we first talked about it with the Southern Alaska group, they said, well, we are not interested in a plan design where retiree benefits go down, because we were talking about that 1953 plan. So it's only since we got the regulations in 2014 that we were able to put a SIP together. So we acted on it really as soon as we could. In fact, Southern Alaska was really working hard on it before we got the 2014 regulations. Those regulations were published in 2014, September of 2014, and they went live with SIP accruals at 1/1/15. And that process for them was about a, I don't know, 2-year process or something to really look hard at it. So they were looking hard at implementing a SIP before we even had a law that said a SIP was permissible. So we were pretty grateful to get those regulations before we had to go talk to the IRS about it. So I really think in terms of why there's so much activity now, it's because these hybrid regulations have opened up some modifications to that 1953 design.
Sean Cushman, Local 1503. Going back to the last slide, or clarification, once you start the SIP plan, you put in what your contribution is going to be paid into. Those will stay the same for, in theory, forever and ever and ever. And we'll never go to what we have right now, which is adding more that are non-accruing funds to that plan. We'll have to put more money that doesn't get us any more bonus with that plan.
So with the, so here's, so the dynamics of how that'll work in the early years is very much like what you have now. If we have another downturn and the underfunded benefits from the past get more underfunded, you may be in a position of having to put more money toward funding past benefits. So yeah, I can't say that we won't ever have to put more in the past, but what we won't have is in 20 years, we will not be trying to, we will not be, I don't know, let me say this right. We're no longer going to be adding risk to the plan. So in 20 years, we won't have to refund or fund again or get, you know, refund the SIP benefits. The SIP benefits will never produce unfunded liability, as long as you're putting in the proper contribution to fund the benefits that are earned each year, which you do. I'm not worried about that.
Lynn Romanovich, Local 30. So in going from an underfunded DB to a SIP, does it take approximately 10 years on average for it to level out?
I will show you an example of that in a minute. The answer is it depends on the plan, and it depends on future market returns in terms of funded status. So that is a very, I wish I could tell you a number. I could put a projection up, you know, that's optimistic and one that's terrible, and we don't really know. But in terms of, I will show you, I have a slide that shows what the liability replacement looks like over time. So you get a sense of what's happening on the liability side. So I don't want to skip the cons, because I don't want you to, I want you to be aware. So benefit decreases are possible but unlikely. For the same cost, if $2 are going into the traditional plan now to build benefits and those same $2 go in to build SIP benefits, the SIP benefits will be smaller initially, but will go up over your lifetime, even into retirement. And this requires a fundamental paradigm shift in thinking. You really have to start thinking about your retirement plan as something that's growing over time. And so you can't be worried about what you see on your statement today. You need to go look at, and there's a calculator on the on your website to go look and see what we expect those to look like at the time you actually retire. It does not solve your legacy liability challenges. Those challenges are still there. We just won't have those same challenges in 15 or 20 years. We've really talked about this. I want to get to something you might care about. All right. I have to tell you this quick story. I want to show you what the benefits look like side by side, DB versus SIP, and I also have DC slides in here. So I'm going to go through these quickly because I think you guys get this. But I'm going to assume a very specific world. I'm going to assume a world where I get 6.6% returns every year. and we have 2.5% inflation every year, and everybody gets $1 million on the day they retire to put into either a defined benefit plan, a defined contribution plan, or a SIP. That's never going to happen, just so you know. None of those things are ever going to happen. All right, so I'm going to give $1 million to my Uncle TJ. I love my Uncle TJ, but, you know, he smokes and he drinks and he rides his motorcycle without a helmet. And he is going to spend, he says, oh, can I take $1 million and just spend it this year? And I said, no, you got to put it in a 401k plan. So he says, all right, I'm going to assume that I live 10 years. I'm going to be dead by the time I'm 75 for sure. So he can spend $120,000 a year for 10 years, and as long as he dies by the time he's 75, that is an awesome retirement plan. Otherwise, he's gonna live in my basement. My Uncle TJ has a brother, Chad, the carpenter, who's mathier than TJ. So Chad did some calculations and he said, I'm gonna spend my 401k money to last until life expectancy. So he can't spend nearly as much as TJ, only like $60,000 a year, but he can make it last for 20 years. And now he has a 50% chance of outliving his assets. That's what life expectancy means. Half of us die before life expectancy and half die after. So after 10 years, Chad will join us in the basement. And these two gentlemen have a sister, my mother, and that woman is determined to never live in my basement. So she's gonna spend less and she is gonna plan to have her money last until she is 95 years old. And she has only a 5% chance of outliving her assets. But she has a 95% chance of having a lower standard of living than she could have. I don't like 401k plans. My dad was a school teacher and then a high school principal, and he has a DB plan. So he's gonna retire with $90,000 a year. Remember, he got $1 million to spend on his DB plan. So he's gonna spend that $90,000 and he's gonna get a nice pension that's nice and flat over his entire lifetime. So he's not gonna get any inflation protection, which at least my mom and her brothers did. But he gets no inflation protection, but he gets lifelong income. That's the benefit you have now. If we take that same $1 million and put it in a sustainable income plan, this is what we get. We get a benefit that it starts out a little lower than the DB and goes up over time. You'll notice that it pretty much matches that life expectancy DC line. The defined contribution line that's in the middle there, that's for Chad who planned to live to life expectancy. That's sort of the magic of a pension plan, whether it's a DB or a SIP, is that we can pool that longevity and provide everybody a benefit based on life expectancy, no matter how long you actually live. So that's what a SIP can do. And actually, for a long service career carpenter, the SIP would do better than this. Because in real life, what happens is we're putting a contribution in for you each year. So if you're a 30-year guy, you get a whole bunch of years that grow quite a bit before you retire. So a career guy, a carpenter, would actually, that SIP benefit starts out a little bit lower than the DB typically, but not that much lower. Sort of it comes on the backs of guys who only work a short time, especially short time later in their careers. So it's a little bit of a different allocation of benefit. But that's what I like about the SIP. And in real life, remember I said there's this drain on 401k assets, higher fees in retirement, lower return over time. The real DC benefits would look like that. So DC plans are simply not as efficient at turning retirement contributions into retirement dollars by about 30%. If we talk about funding, question.
Hello, my name is Tony Vasquez from Local 15003 in Portland. Could you go back a slide? I wanted to ask a question about that chart. So there's a lot of people that are 5 years, mm-hmm. 10 years away from retirement, probably in this room. If I got my old account, that's gonna be separate than my new account. Are these going to be like two different payments that come to me when I retire? We take this.
Yeah, you would have one check. But there would be, when you elect your benefit, there's gonna be two pieces. The piece that is the traditional plan and you elect it and it stays fixed, and then a piece that's the SIP that'll change over time.
So if I'm investing at, so my new plan, it looks to me like I'm gonna God, how do I say this? That it's going to be less value than what I'm putting into it for a little while. Because I'm at the yellow line, and if I would have been at the blue line, I would have been solid. So now, for the next 5 years, and I'm going to retire, and I'm going to get less money than what I put into it, because I'm still not up to that break-even line that you say I'm going to pass and go on. So in the new plan, I'm not like a career guy. I'm short-term in the new plan.
Yeah, so let's talk about the winners and losers. Anytime you make a change to a plan, there are what we call winners and there are what we call losers. And I don't mean they're winners and losers. I just mean they're people who kind of benefit more or less from the design. So you are absolutely right. The guy who is 5 years from retirement, it's going to take, he's going to be well into retirement before his SIP benefit catches up to what his traditional benefit would have been. Because it starts out lower and builds over time. Well, it starts out lower and he doesn't have as many years to build. It will catch up, but it may not catch up when you're 68. It may catch up when you're 75. So that is completely true that for guys really close to retirement, they won't get as much value out of the SIP as they would have gotten from the traditional plan. On the other hand, the guys who are 30 now never saw a 4% accrual. They never saw ad hoc increases to their benefits. So, and I mean, we need to be upfront about that. It's just that is how it works. So for an older guy, he's not gonna get as much value out of this plan as a younger guy will. I mean, if he lives a really long time, he'll be money ahead potentially, but if he dies when he's 75, he's not gonna be money ahead on the SIP design.
Scott Hanson, Local 1281. With that, I think it's very, very important to mention the sustainability and that same idea what you're talking about, because I'm in that position, you know, whatever, 5, 10 years. And so with the Alaska plan, and I really thought about that and say, well, it's going to be a less benefit, you know, for me, I'm a loser, you know. So, but I looked at it, you know, and as a trustee on the plan, I looked at it as overall, you know, if we hit another 2008 and we end up losing our whole pension, having to go to the pension guarantee, you know, with the feds, you know, you get 30 cents on the dollar. So I think that's the whole thing, sustainability.
Yeah, that's actually a very, very good point, because what we'll see is the risk profile change of the plan over time, so that when the next 2008 happens, your plan will be able to weather that. It won't be an even more mature plan that can't solve its funding problems. It'll be a plan where half of the liability or more than half of the liability is SIP liability, and you'll be able to sustain that. So really for retirees, a big risk would be if we stick with the traditional design and 20 years from now we have another 2008, we don't want to look like the Central States plan where guys are getting cents on the dollar in terms of benefits. So as much as it's true, if we just look at the traditional DB compared to the SIP, you might not be money ahead. The plan is in a much better position to make it through another downturn without benefit declines. That's a very good point, Scott.
Linda Romanovich, Local 30. So looking at the demographics of the workforce, more people, if I understand what you're saying, are gonna be losers in the next 5 to 10 years than winners. Is that correct?
Well, you're so that might be true for the people who will be retiring in the next 5 or 10 years, but not for the younger guys who are retiring 10 years after that.
I'm talking baby boomers, which the demographics, what we have here, I'm just trying to speculate, and when I report back to my members, I want to have sort of real life words to tell them. So if in fact more of them will be hurt in the next 10 years, they need to know that.
Right. So I think what you're saying is correct, but remember that what they've earned in the past doesn't change. So they get what they have now, and then we're going to layer something on top of it. And what we're layering on top is going to be for a guy who's older is going to be smaller than what he would have gotten before. Again, going up over time, it'll catch up sometime. We don't know when it'll catch up because it's dependent on the markets.
Yeah, Sean Kushner, 1503 again. Yeah, that's why I keep thinking. I want to, you know, get clarification because you just said it, I believe. I don't know if anybody heard it. I'm vested in the plan that we have right now. Let's say that I'm going to get $2,800 a month at retirement right now. In 5 years, I'm in the baby boomers, I can retire. I'm still going to get that $2,800
And now I'm gonna get maybe a smaller amount of my SIP added onto it depending on when it starts. So I'm not gonna get just a $1,000 payment, I'm gonna get a $4,000 payment.
Well, it'll depend on those SIP accruals, right? But you're gonna get your 28 bucks you've already accrued, and then we're gonna, just like you would in a traditional DB plan, we're gonna layer benefits on top, but the benefits we're layering on top have a different structure where they start out lower and get higher over time. There's the sound bite. See, you have to work a long time to get the actuary there.
Sam Maria, Local 271. Don't go out and scare the baby boomers. Actually go out and help the millennials to actually save it for them.
What happens to the SIP plan if a new federal administration comes in and changes the regulations under which this is structured?
Well, that's a good question. So let me talk about the 2014 regulations a little bit. The 2014 regulations were about 15 years in the making. I don't think that they are going to change. That is, usually the kinds of changes they make are not about plan design, they are about funding rules. It is possible we would see a difference in funding rules. I am not concerned that the funding rules would affect the funding of a SIP. I have one concern with a SIP, and that is the IRS has failed to weigh in on how we would pay lump sums, but we don't intend to pay lump sums anyway. So in terms of the legal concerns I have, the one concern I have is not material to the plan. So I feel like we're in pretty sure footing. I don't think we're going to get a law that changes that. Quickly on funding, we already talked about this. We talked about how the liability in a plan grows over time and you end up with lots of retirees. We back that with volatile assets, resulting in plan underfunding over time. And you can see the volatility in that funding. What happens in a SIP looks like this. We start with the asset profile. Remember, liabilities move to match the assets. The difference between the asset line and the liability line is the stabilization reserve, which results in a plan that's over 100% funded all the time. I was going to tell the story of how we ended up with a SIP at the Southern Alaska Carpenters. The short version is I introduced the 1953 design, and Jerry Auville said, that's fine except for the part where the retiree benefits go down. And now we have the sustainable income plan. We talked about this, we alluded to this slide a lot. We talked about how this plan design doesn't change the risk, the SIP doesn't change the risk profile immediately. It takes time. So it's not something that it's an overnight fix. So this is the liability projection for the Southern Alaska plan. You can see that we expect the liability of that plan to go up over time. Lots of things are changing from year to year. People are retiring, people are dying, people are earning new benefits. There's all sorts of things happening, but this is what we expect to have happen to the liability over time. The red bar, the red area is the liability that's been already accrued. The liability for benefits earned in the past. That's the liability that we can't do anything about. It's a bit under, it's underfunded. You're gonna have to do something about that. But that's the liability that's already on the books. However, and we only, that only goes down as people die. Just to be really frank about that. That number goes down as people die. The new benefits, what are we gonna do for benefits earned in the future? That's the green area. So you can see that in year one, we don't do much to change the risk profile. Out of year 10, we are about 25% SIP, 75% traditional plan liability, and after 20 years, we're past 50% SIP liability. A 2008, 20 years from now, would be much, much easier to manage when we have less than half the liability in benefits that are volatile, or rather in funding that is volatile. So that's kind of gets at what the process looks like. It is not an immediate fix. At the break, I was talking to somebody and they said, is there a lot of movement out there in terms of changing design? And the answer is yes. Some started before 2014. There's more interest since those 2014 hybrid regulations. And what's happened is when we went back to sort of the drawing board to try to figure out how to prevent retiree benefits from declining, we looked at every plan design we could find. Things that were implemented, things people were writing articles about. We did as much research as we could. We sat down, we dreamed up our own things, and then we looked at each one of those provisions in turn and said, does this help us meet the goals of staying funded and preventing retiree benefit declines, yes or no? What are the risks? What's the risk profile of this provision? And we looked at a whole bunch of provisions. I'm not going to go through those, but we ended up at this cap and shore strategy after months and months of thinking about it. The time is now. Southern Alaska went live January 1, 2015. Washington, Idaho, Montana intends to go live in 2016. It's never final till it's final, but that's the intent, and Oregon and Western Washington are looking at it. In terms of other plans outside of the Northwest Regional Council of Carpenters, we have one plan that went live in New Jersey in 2016. We have two others that are certain in that certain way, and that's, you know, never certain till it's certain, but we have two more set for 2017. We have interest from several more plans, and we're starting to see interest from corporate plans, which I thought would take about 10 more years, so I'm pretty excited about that. That is my phone number. Try talking to a trustee before you call me, but that's my phone number. That is not my cell phone. I may have to start screaming my desk phone. If you want more information, though, there's some websites up there, but the Northwest Regional Council site has all the rollout materials for Southern Alaska, which has pretty good high-level discussion, and then the nuts and bolts for that plan. Making a change to something that's been in place for 50 years is a hard thing to do. And you have leadership that is courageous enough to make that change.
Can you just clarify one more time about the when the Western Washington, Oregon, this was going to go into effect?
So that would require action from trustees that has not yet occurred.
Oh, I'm sorry, I thought.
Yep. Yep.
Ray Mack, 808, Wyoming. I just want to know, what is it going to take to break the PBGC?
Not much.
Because that's what our plan has been taken over by. Yeah. We're in default.
So that's a good question. So let's talk just very briefly about the PBGC. The PBGC stands for Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation. It functions much like a stopgap for retirement plans in the way that the FDIC provides a stopgap against banks. So, you know, the FDIC will insure a certain amount of money you have in a bank. If you have $2 million in the bank, it doesn't insure the whole thing. The PBGC provides some retirement benefits. When plans run out of money, the PBGC will provide a lesser benefit to participants. The PBGC collects premiums from every plan every year. However, since 2008, the PBGC has been expected to run out of assets. And the Wyoming plan is at PBGC levels and being paid by the PBGC. The health of the PBGC has struggled, and with the central states, we now know the central states plan will actually go to the PBGC when they run out of assets, which will be, I think it's within a couple of years. So it's not imminent, but the PBGC is not well funded. I don't know what the intentions are. I do know that the PBGC has been asked to provide a report to Congress, so we will know more, and they do produce a report every year, but I don't know what the intended fixes are to the PBGC. I wish I had a better answer than that, but that's sort of where that stands. We know that given the current funding of the PBGC, if the premiums paid to the PBGC stay at the same level, central states alone is enough to bring them down. And we now know that the central states will land at the PBGC. So whether there will be some government subsidization of the PBGC is yet to be determined.
Thank you very much, Kelly.
Thank you.